without more ado, we're going to get the panel up. This panel is, well, it's a really simple one, actually. It's just to enable and speed up transformational change at global level. So, okay, that should take us through till about 1:45. So, no silver bullet, et cetera, as we've all said, but lots of potential solutions and solutions global downwards, governmental, institutional downwards, but also some really interesting stuff coming up at local level. Let me, without more ado, ask Barbara, Angelo, Guido, and Roberto to come up and take their seats in the coconut shy. Welcome all. I'll do some quick introductions. Barbara, who you will discern over here, is a BCFN advisor and executive director of climate finance at the Climate Policy Initiative. Angelo Riccaboni is chair of the Prima Foundation. The Prima program is charged with implementing a decade-long innovation to change food and water systems. How's it going, I'm wondering? Guido Schmidt-Traub is executive director of the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network, and Gunhild has already told him what he's going to say, so we can see if he'll stick to the script. No pressure there, Guido. And Roberto Ridolfi is special advisor to the FAO, the Food Agriculture Organization, of course, of the UN. So give him a round of applause. Welcome, panel. Now, Barbara, you have a BCFN hat on as well as very other hats in your daily life. I don't know if you're going to talk about BCFN, but take a couple of minutes to set out your stall on this. Global sure. solutions or local solutions or both?
So, well, I think you need the local to get global. So, but again, it's a pleasure being here. Again, I do have two hats today, so I'm going to actually very briefly just give you a little bit what we do at the BCFN in order to, you know, enable this transformation, go towards a global solutions, and then share a little bit and concrete, actually, public-private initiative that we're running at CPI, which is, again, coming back a little bit to the overall theme of the panel here. So in terms of the Brillo Center for Food and Nutrition, where I've been lucky to be on the board since its very beginning, I think the goal was always to really promote a dialogue on how you produce and consume food along the three dimensions of sustainable development. And how the BCFN is doing is basically through three elements, which I think has become very clear today already, which is one, research and really gathering knowledge and best practices. Second is convenings like today to really bring together the different stakeholders. And the third is also a call for action to really try to find new concrete ideas. And I do want to, as always, also point to the youth context, the BCFN Yes contest that we have, where we really are looking for specific local solutions that hopefully, however, can trigger transformation towards a global, the global solutions. So through these three elements, the BCFN is trying to basically show what's the best practices in terms of local solutions. And for me, I think this is really the basis of then thinking how we can best share this knowledge and replicate what works on a global level. So if you've had a chance to look at the BCFN policy recommendations that are out very nicely, I think there's three of the four policy recommendations are really around knowledge. How can you better gather knowledge? How can you better show what are the best case studies? What are good, successful projects? And how can you then really make sure that this knowledge is distributed to all the ones that can really take the solutions and replicate them? And also, how can you make sure that you actually focus on educating across the different types of stakeholders, including really the youth? Yeah. So I think for me, it's like...
It's all on your pamphlets that I was waiting this morning.
All on your pamphlets.
Okay.
Read them. They're very well. They're very well done. So a really good one. But so I'd like just to focus on the one area that a specific public-private initiative that we're running at CPI. And I want to take the opportunity actually to come back of some of the issues that have been mentioned before also from Leo and take a specific lens of finance. What we see globally, if you look at mitigation, adaptation, the nexus between food, agriculture, and environment is that we are falling far short what is needed in terms of investments of getting us towards a low-carbon, climate-resilient, sustainable future. So there is really the need to focus on actions, on real kind of investment vehicles that really can bring the money to those that then can implement the solutions that we're coming up with here. So at CPI, what we are doing is we are running the Global Innovation Lab for Climate Finance. which is a public-private initiative that brings together investor experts from the public and private sector, from governments, from development finance institutions, from commercial banks, institutional investors, and project developers. The overall goal is to unlock private investment. And again, also, Leah has mentioned that in his speech as well, the importance of really using public money most effectively to unlock private investment, which is the only way to get us to the scale that can really address the SDGs. And I'm going to finish here, but just to say this lab, we have a specific focus that we've actually managed to launch yesterday with IFAD, and I know IFAD was here early today, on smallholders. And so we really want to focus on concrete financial instruments that can increase access to finance to smallholders and doing that in a sustainable way. And we have seen that the lab has actually managed to have a track record already. We've mobilized $1.3 billion for concrete projects, and we do hope with the specific focus on smallholders that we'll help also come up with the solutions that then can be replicated on a global level.
Okay, Barbara, thanks very much. Angelo, Prima, are you changing the world? Practical solutions.
Yes, thank you. Yes, Prima is a major initiative which was launched 1 year ago after 6 years of work. It is an initiative to promote innovation in food systems, food systems and water resources. So as we said before, you need solutions, you need concrete solutions. So we have a budget of €500 million over 7 years. And the budget is given by both the European Commission and 19 countries. So another dimension that should be added in this discussion is that food innovation can be also a tool for scientific diplomacy. Studying together, working together, implementing together solutions. Researchers from the north and the south of the Mediterranean can also build trust. And trust is a rather important issue nowadays. So the idea here is to use this money in order to implement in the field, and mainly in southern Mediterranean countries, initiatives, innovation, able to deal with major issues in water efficiency and food value chains. We have started 1 year ago in terms of calls. It was a huge success. We have had 800 partnerships applying for it for 40 grants. We have had 5,000 research units, 25,000 researchers applying for it from 24 countries. So there's a huge need to do it. And what is important is that solutions are clear. For instance, we have a project related to the promotion, production, and consumption of camel milk, or we have a project to use olive meal wastewaters, or we have a project related to the use of blockchain in agriculture. So concrete initiatives. And we are funding them. The first 40 winners will be appointed at the end of the year. And now we start with the second flow, which we start early 2019. So the idea is to find good projects, to fund them, and then try to scale up. Maybe it was mentioned before, we need to find good initiatives and to scale up. So this is the major part of the work of Prima. Prima is a foundation located in Barcelona. I'm the chair of the foundation. We have 12 staff full-time working on that. But that is important, but it's not important only funding research innovation. As it was said this morning, we need also to fund or to promote dialogue, to involve stakeholders. So we are doing other initiatives in parallel. One within the umbrella of Prima is a massive open online course that is a MOOC on Mediterranean perspective in food systems, which was produced in cooperation with the BCFN and with SDSN, all acronyms, sorry, Alex, but now we are aware what they are. And that is very important because in only a few weeks, we have had 2,500 applicants to the MOOC, which is a very good result.
Okay, and I'm going to stop you there.
Yes.
I'm going to stop because it's a very good outline. There are some clear practical initiatives, yeah, first off, and also the educational thing. And yeah, I think with that kind of response, it's clear you're getting your message out there. Yeah. People are coming back to you. Guido, how do we mobilize globally from your perspective at the UN?
Well, I'm not at the UN, so we partner with the UN, but we're an independent initiative. Mm-hmm. We need to we need to do global local action, obviously. So let me tell you what Gunhild really wanted to say in her presentation.
Touché.
These are very complex issues, and I think we all know this. We all get, all of us are working on specific solutions. That's really wonderful. How do these pieces come together globally and locally? And let me just give you a couple of examples just from the last 12 months, basically. One of the largest countries in the world has just adopted a massive biofuel policy to increase farmers' incomes. Have they looked at what that might mean for food security, water, biodiversity? No, they haven't, because they don't even have the capacity to do so. Another country, a small, highly developed country, has just recently had its whole land use system completely upended because all of a sudden one of its major trading partners has developed a voracious appetite for dairy products. And it's completely changed the dairy industry, and it's completely upended the land use system. The one country I'm going to mention is, because I am from Europe, is the European Commission. We have a common agricultural policy that we all know, and, but it is a ship passing in the night when we're looking at food and nutrition issues. Those topics don't talk to each other. We don't have the mechanisms in place
still
to do this. Not to this day. There is another reform that's being discussed, but we have a production logic, and we have a health logic. And what Gunhild and others have shown is that we need to be looking at healthy food, producing and health. So these things all come together. And finally, another very large country, is projecting massive increases in demand in import of food and feed. But there's no clear sense whether the exporting countries actually can deliver that. So this is where the system really goes off the rail. And we can talk about, and I'm all for solutions, we need to drive them up, but if we don't put this together, we're not going to get anywhere. And we certainly won't solve this problem. So what do we need? We need clear targets. Gunnar has spoken about healthy diets, that's one. We also need a much clearer target on biodiversity, for example. It's a thing that always seems to fall through the cracks, so we're working on that. We obviously need to have clearer targets on greenhouse gas emission. There's a whole lot of analysis, but if you ask anyone to see what is the target, what do we need to aim for in terms of land-based emissions by 2050, you get a range of numbers that's this wide. Sure. So we've got a lot of the analysis, but we need to do that. So that's the first thing. The second is countries need to be able to actually look at these things quantitatively. This is not what a bunch of great modelers can do out of Potsdam, out of Vienna, out of anywhere in the world for the country. You actually need the teams in country, and that right now doesn't exist. There's one exception, that's Brazil. There's a lot that's going wrong in Brazil right now. In fact, they're regressing on many of the progress made, but Brazil did make a major contribution which enabled the success of the Paris Climate Agreement, okay, which was a zero deforestation pledge, one sentence. And that was based on a deep integrated analysis. And what we're trying to do now with the Food Atlantis Coalition, building that capacity, we're working currently with 25 countries, large and small, to build this capacity.
Right, so cross-communication targets, and also what Gunhild was saying in her presentation, the need to properly measure as you move towards these targets as well is an imperative. Roberto, making SDGs mainstream, walk out on the street in New York and say, you know, what's an SDG? And they'll look at you like you've come from Mars.
And guess what? The FAO is UN, and is Food and Agriculture Organization. In the past, we have been concentrating on the A of the FAO. Now it's time to go into the F, very, very heavily. FAO produces flagship reports every year on the state of food security and nutrition, just out 20 days ago, where you read and everybody uses the figures and the data. And next month, on the 15th of October, will come out the Food of State and Agriculture. Very interesting, this time will be linked to migration. Migration starts from rural-urban before becoming international. Never forget that. If you don't give a very, very serious expectations to young people in the rural areas that they can become rich in the rural areas with agriculture, they will always go to town. But I want to tell something about the donut word. You see, in Uganda, there is a word called baraza, which means exactly the same. Baraza is the shadow of a tree, but the expression is used to get the community around the tree, in the shade of the tree, to discuss problems of the community. So very, very similar to the Norwegian one you mentioned. The Deputy Director General, Maria Elena Semedo, will, if he's not already here, but she will come here to do the conclusion later on. So she will give the broad perspective. I came here actually out of curiosity. In June in Brussels, we had a similar discussion. Very interesting. We were flying over the sky. And I came to New York now to become more concrete. I will have one proposition, which I will try to make while we discuss.
Right, 1 minute, one proposition. What is it?
The proposition is mainstreaming SDG is a matter of making the very complex science of the 242 indicators of the SDG simple. Clustering it according functional activities, livestock, grain, horticulture, you name it, but also the value chain of food system, clustering the indicators, progressing with the technical competencies that we have. Don't remember that we have done in FIO the RAI, the Responsible Agricultural Investment. For agriculture, that has been 10 years before the SDGs, what now the SDGs are. And the convening power of UN agencies with governments will allow the policy incentives or the pool of the policies to combine with the mainstreaming in the private sector. So I will elaborate later on in the next intervention what is the proposal for SDG compliance through mainstreaming. Financial institutions.
Can you tell me that now in 20 seconds?
Yes.
Right,
financial institutions. You imagine you are a bank.
Yep.
He wants to do an investment. And you tell him, look, I give you the money, but you have to be compliant to SDG.
Yeah.
We got it.
Right.
How can
Which
I
impose
you?
Which we don't do at the moment.
He will do it.
Yeah.
Because SDG is good for business. If it's not good today, it will be tomorrow. If it not will be tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, but we are coming to it.
Right. Okay. Now, we're, as you may notice, fighting the clock. So, global, feel free, sir. Global solutions, local solutions. They've got some, and they've laid them out. You've got a lot more. We have no time at all, but I'm going to waste even more of it by getting your thoughts and your observations. I haven't been down here yet, so come on, guys. Questions, observations, solutions, local and global. Yes, at the back there, please. Do tell us who you are.
Good afternoon. My name is Ndidi Muneli. I'm a social entrepreneur based in Lagos, founder of Ace Foods and Sahel Consulting Agriculture and Nutrition. Now, when I listen to you speaking, one of the frustrations I have is that we have a very siloed approach to addressing food. And in my context, obviously, food and nutrition affects health, education, every single sector. What can governments do and funders do to alter this siloed approach? We're not going to address the food challenges facing us if we continue to chip at it from different sense, parts of the puzzle. How can we mainstream food through the different channels that affect it? And what practical solutions would you recommend from a government and funder perspective? Thank you.
Thank you. And Guido, of course, was saying too many people, I think, in effect, the same thing. No cross-communication. I want to get several points, and then we'll throw them back to the panel and very unfairly give them no time at all to answer. Yes, sir.
Simpson de Silva from Caribbean Agri. Caribbean Healthy Food and Caribbean Agribusiness Association. I'm from Guyana. What is it could be done to make sure at events like these, you deliberately invite or get the stakeholders involved? For example, I'm from the Caribbean or CARICOM region, and I'm here just because of personal involvement. But I think there need to be a systematic, or sorry, a special mechanism to make sure that the representatives from the various countries are involved at these activities. Because if we do not, then we are just leaving tens of countries out of the equation.
Sure.
And these engagements are so important, are so fundamental. And I know personally that at least 15 countries in the Caribbean are seriously interested in being part of these activities. But unfortunately, they are not involved. So I am appealing for some special mechanism by institutions like
In FAO,
BC.
In FAO, you have those
special mechanisms. I'm fortunate to have been to a lot of activities over the last year or two with FAO.
Okay, okay. Well, I'll leave you there, because the point's well
the
made.
The point is
point's
we,
well
need
made.
To,
we need to
yeah,
engage more.
Yes,
let's
please.
Go silos, bunkers thinking first of all. Who wants to come back on that? We're all too much in our own silos. We need to break them down. I think, Guido, you were really addressing that a bit.
Yeah, I think countries need a plan of what to do. That's not, there's no, obviously you cannot plan this with any finality over 25 years, but we need to have a real discussion. So what does this need first of all? You actually need an analysis of the food system. It has to be geospatially explicit. So what is the map? What do you need in terms of biodiversity protection, where food production, et cetera? How can you, what are the options for optimizing? And that's the starting point for a conversation. Of course, it has to be integrated in the trade analysis because Nigeria imports a lot of its food. You do a first technical analysis and then discuss it with all the different stakeholders. So what that means, first of all, a whole of government approach, you get the different ministries, not just agriculture, natural resource, water, but also finance and trade, trade and industry around Monte. Well, that's what Brazil has done imperfectly, but they've done it. Actually, they're doing this around this analytical tool, and you have similar discussions with the different stakeholders. Obviously for global discussions, but my view is that all food ultimately is local. I think one of the biggest gaps that I see is to have these conversations in every single country. And that's what we really need to do so that we can work on the solutions, but have an understanding of how it fits into the overall strategy.
Okay, and every single country brings us to the second point, which, Roberto, you're bursting about that.
No, I think I want to reinforce this point. It exists already. I mean, when you do a national development plan in Nigeria, all the different government departments are consulting. If it's not the case, then elections should say something about that. In principle, FAO is assisting all countries in doing exactly this. Analysis of the food system in certain cases could be done better than in others, but all the facets of science are taken into consideration. Point is implementation. I have seen the most beautiful policy document, Alex, staying in a nice desk with a little bit of dust on top of it and not being
haven't
implemented.
Haven't we all? Yeah.
That is the point.
Yeah, right. Okay, yeah, I'm going to
I want to add to that because I think...
Very briefly.
I think I agree with Guido. That's the basis to start like with a plan like that. But I do think we need some more accountability from countries. So what I think is needed is actually a little bit building on your proposal from before, ideally coming up with a SDG, you know, metrics framework where actually you can start really looking at the different countries and really understand what is happening and you know, kind of bring the different initiatives together in a way. Because if you have some kind of like accountability framework where at least countries have to show what they do and at which stage they are, I think that can help to really kind of, you know, foster kind of some action
okay.
there.
Now, I'm going to give you guys a warning. I'm going to come back to you very soon, and you're going to have 1 minute with a magic wand to do the one initiative that you would like to make, if you had the power, okay, to get things moving, get things changing. So ponder that a little bit. Meanwhile, a couple of quick points. Yes, gentlemen, right here.
Hello, my name is Ingo Pool. I'm a founder of a company called Vapao. It's using algae to make snacks as a non-traditional plant-based source of protein. And my question is about actually non-traditional plant-based or sometimes actually insect-based protein sources and like stuff that grows in water. And I feel that maybe in this discussion what I have missed all day so far is actually the consideration of these like futuristic non-traditional protein sources like algae, like insects, and the barriers they face to commercialization. Like, for example,
right.
If you want algae...
Leave it there. Don't need the example. The points were made, and the reason you've missed it is because it hasn't been here. So you're absolutely right. Yeah, we haven't touched on that. Alternative food sources. Anybody want to make a quick point on that?
No.
They're all looking utterly terrified. You, sir, get the award for our totally shutting up a panel and indeed mentioning something that hasn't been brought up today.
That was not correct.
Hasn't been brought up today. Right, final point over here.
No,
oh, who haven't we been to? I think we've had a medal, have you?
I'll speak very loudly. I think we can. So I'm Gina Bria, head of the Hydration Foundation, and I want to just bring the relationship of hydration to nutrition to talk about the best possible water being found inside fruits and vegetables and that support of agriculture and then the planet through water-based foods
is a really important part of our nutrition conversation. I hope we can continue to have that. So,
fantastic. Yeah. Two points there, right at the forefront of technology. Go on then. Your question?
Not a question, actually. Roberto, amazing delivery. I wanted to touch base on this concept and what mainstream is, and I'm here to represent. I'm representing a company called Insergo and Chef's Manifesto, where we work with a lot of youth, a lot of kids, more or less. But what is mainstream, at least for me? I do have a question for the audience. Who in here is under 25 by show of hands? One, two, what is that, 30? 30 heads? Who in here is over 35? No worries.
And that's pretty good for these conferences, actually.
Right? So that's interesting, because what is mainstream? To me, is pop culture is mainstream, especially in America. So when we talk about the FAO, and we want to tackle food, I think mainstream is really leading towards chefs and getting kids activated with cooking and chefs and the culture around it, the coolness about it. But my question is, like, at a conference like this, why isn't there a class here with teenagers? Why isn't there an organization that's putting together to get youth right in here? And like, because these kids are activated. They're extremely smart. And I know most of us are in this phase in our life where we're creating legacy of our families, legacy of our companies. But the kids are ready to rock. The kids are ready to get, you know, they're ready to rock. You know, they're ready to see what's up.
Well, let's do an offshoot conference for the kids. Thank you very much.
Yeah, but
alas, we are against the clock. I can't take any more, but these guys are going to stick around. So let's be really unfair. You have 1 minute, Guido, and you've got a magic wand. What's the one thing that you would really do to shift initiatives and make change? It could be global, it could be local, it could be just knocking down a silo wall. Go.
We need to have a serious conversation in every country what it means to achieve the goals. This is not about just individual solutions, it's about putting them together. If algae are the solution, well, let's figure out what it means quantitatively. What can they really, really do? Put it into a framework and then start testing it. If it delivers, it's going to be a big part of the solution. If it doesn't, it's not. But we need to really have an integrated discussion around these issues now.
Fantastic. Magic wand has come to Roberto.
Yes, mainstreaming, okay? Financial system. Without the financial system, we go nowhere. Because the big companies like Barilla or like Unilever, they can afford the sustainability. They can afford the heat of the market. They can afford not to be competitive in a certain edging space. But the small and medium, unless they are pushed by the supplier chain, they don't do it. So banks. So the financial system must deliver sustainable finance for sustainable investments. And this must be compliant. Compliant is simple, as I say. Shouldn't be compulsory from day zero on everything. Should be little by little, gradual, but always incremental. And then you start from soil management. You do agriculture, you want to maintain the soil healthy. In China, the big problem on agriculture is public spending on health, I think even more than United States. So now they realize that polluting the soil is not good for the future. So I agree with you that we have to involve the young generation. How can I attract not only chefs,
Roberto, that's three things.
But also farmers?
2 minutes.
You had the banks, you had the soil. Fantastic. This three. You used your magic wand very effectively.
I don't play with you anymore.
Now be quiet. He's not going to play with me anymore. That's it. It's all over. Angelo, one thing. One thing.
Yes.
Okay, go.
Certainly education. I mean, finance is important, but also to educate, especially children. You said that in the US you don't have major initiatives educating youngsters. In other countries there are. So maybe we should bring other experiences, other programs, other materials, and to localize them. But education is very, very important, because if we push children push the family pushes the politicians, policymakers can make decisions coherent with a new framework. So certainly education.
Great. Dialogues, banks, education. Barbara, you began, you get to finish.
I like it.
In 1 minute.
In a moment. Well, I had two things, but Angela said one, so I think education is one. For me, it's finance. Again, this is what I know best. What I would do is I would have a specific stream on how to come up with sustainable food solutions under this innovation lab that we're running, and really try to, you know, mobilize and catalyze money that goes to the local solutions and hopefully then see how we can replicate them. It's about finance.
Great stuff. Barbara, thank you very much. Guido, Roberto, Angelo, give them a round of applause. Thanks very much, guys. Thank you.